Hi, I'm Tex, and I've been christened Tex by Microsoft. We've been doing this user group since 2008. Finally, we are on a regular cadence, effective 2017. So this is our second meeting, fourth Wednesday of every month. So you can count on us. You don't have to come in as long as you sign it online, and you can actually see the stuff from wherever you are in your PJs, no worries. So, welcome. Those who come in get pizza, get to meet other folks, you get to network, you get to meet Adam, who's a Microsoft architect. So, you know, you got questions you can get answered. You can't do that online, I'm sorry. So that's the incentive to come in. And we've got some regulars over here, familiar faces. The crowd's small, growing, it keeps varying based on topic. And you get to meet people who actually do stuff.
That is key.
That, I think, is the most essential part of our group. We are not tied to any specific community or technology or company or vendor. We are all about trying to put forth something to cut through the noise. So if you are interested in understanding what you can do from people who actually do, this is an opportunity. Most of the stuff we give away is no charge. We don't charge for anything. If you get the free parking, you're lucky. If you don't get the free parking, I apologize. You know, there's only so much we can do for no charge. And without taking more of your time, this is Phil Wheat, former Microsoft architect evangelist, head of the Architect Council. You're getting to speak to someone who actually does stuff, was a guest on the Stephen Fry show, Over the Pond, and multiple other shows. You can see him online with beautiful robotic stuff. I'm going to hand it off to him and let him present and show you what is available. Have fun. Cheers.
Thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
All right, we're small enough group today. I'm going to do what I like to do best. I don't get presentations, I get talks. If you've got questions or different directions you want us to go into, please feel free to interrupt me and let's just get you guys what you need rather than me going slide A, slide B, slide C. What you're going to see is this is my first time doing this particular topic. I'm actually working on an actual course for Learn Now Online. They will put up there, so you'll see kind of the light version that'll go here. If you actually are interested, keep in touch with Tex, and when it goes up live, if you're interested in actually doing the full course, there'll be a lot more details and examples and pieces there. So you're going to see the light version, or as I call it, as I'm getting started with it. So we'll go through all of that. Drop this up. And this is an overview of Docker. It's interesting talking about Docker because it is both very, very simple and fairly complex. Yes, it's kind of like Git. If you're used to getting Git, if you're used to working with Git, you'll know getting started with it, 15 minutes and you're good to go with it. Until you start working with commits and checkouts and branches and that, you know, all that kind of stuff. And you can get very, its power is that it lets you do pretty much anything that you want to do. Unfortunately, that means you can also shoot your foot in any way you want. What you're going to see with Docker is there's a lot of those same concepts as we go through here. A little bit of background. I started out with Docker with my current company. We do an embedded system. It's a drone detection system that's supposed to sit out on a 20-foot pole, so it's got to be nice and durable and work with that. We also needed to have, make sure that the software could move around a little bit. So we got people with Macs, we got people with, we were actually targeting Linux, and we got Windows as well. So as we're moving it through, we needed something to kind of put everything together and give us some kind of isolation from what's going on with the underlying operating system and with the underlying hardware. Virtual machines are very common for this. But then you know that if you start with virtual machines, you've got Hyper-V, you've got Softbox, you've got Vagrant, you've got all this other stuff that's out there that really kind of has a lot. It's fairly heavy to do and it's fairly incompatible across it. So what we did was, we said, okay, let's take a look at the new .NET Core, because that's nice and cross-compatible. And then let's use Docker to actually have these images so that when we're actually doing deploys, as we're doing maintenance on different pieces, it's all going to kind of be in the same place. So instead of having to have a lot of people going in for these embedded systems to make sure there's updates, do all that kind of stuff, it's just basically take an image, test it, run it, and then blow it down, and then basically be able to have a central repository. So literally a script comes down, pulls it all in, and we know that everybody's running the same way. And again, it's running, if we're doing the web interface on ASP.NET Core, you can run on Mac, you can run on Linux, you can run on it can run on Windows, and it doesn't matter, it just pops in and does that. Interesting thing though, one of the pieces that's going on is we had two components, one of which is the web interface, the other of which is basically a service that runs to actually read all the hardware. They're doing a lot of interesting stuff with some very kind of cutting edge devices. So there are some interesting things I'll go through here, whereas you don't normally see it on cloud. As you know, kind of Docker is the darling of the cloud. It's, you know, the Microsoft teams have been going nuts over Docker. AWS has their own repositories. Everybody really likes that to push it to the cloud. Just go, okay, we've got swarms and all that kind of stuff. But what I did with our coordinator, though, is flip it around on the other side. It's actually kind of isolated there, but we've actually got to go down and take a look at some of that hardware, do some of the USB stuff, to actually work with the network stack, do some things like that. So as we get to that point, I'll actually talk to you about not just using it as push it to the cloud or push it to a host, but actually using it on your machines themselves as a client technology, so you can actually have everything put together. So kind of just some coverage on there and where we're kind of starting on this. One thing I do always want to point out is there is Docker and there's Docker. The company, Docker.com, does the product, Docker. So one of the things I always like to do, especially if I'm taking on infrastructure, is what's the business model? Because if, you know, okay, it's great, open source, we've got all this other stuff, okay, what happens when it gets depreciated or something else happens? So Docker develops and supports the Docker system. They do the containers, they put all that in place. They maintain the container repositories. This is where they pay them money, and that they make a little bit of money so they can pay their developers. Like to know where that is, like to know what comes up with that. And handles team integration and public-private repositories. So what you're actually going to see is, if you're doing things like, we also use GitHub, that's kind of a source control repository. There's actually the ability to tie GitHub into Docker. And actually when you do a commit and do a push up into GitHub, it'll automatically build that Docker container for you, have it set up, and you just pull it back down on the other side. So it's one of those places where having that integration in place is very useful. That being said, Docker the company, has opened up how these containers work. Everybody can take a look at it, and I can see what's happened to that. So you've got things like Google's that will run your Docker container, but it is not anything of the Docker runtime on the back end. They've got their own custom runtime that they put together that has different capabilities than you would see on that. You've got different things such as if you're running Ubuntu versus Mac versus Windows, what's going on underneath on the runtime is different. And this is one of those pieces where different companies are actually going through and doing the different pieces. That's why I said keep an eye out on the company itself that's doing this, because you want to pay attention to what's happening here, because you don't want a situation where they have the standard and then it branches off and does a bunch of different things on the back end. Now you lose that compatibility that you're working on, that you're really hoping to have between all the different pieces. One of the big pieces that just happened with that runtime is on Windows. Windows 10. It did use, Docker did use Softbox for running the VMs underneath the hood. They just changed over, and now it's running Hyper-V. This actually caused me a bit of grief, because what does Hyper-V still not allow? Get access to the USB ports,
right.
which was a real pain. So you can actually get access to the USB ports on Linux and Mac, but not on Windows, because Hyper-V doesn't allow that. So these are some of the things to pay attention to. That again, if you're doing cloud, if you're doing something on some kind of hosted solution, you're not going to go on that hardware. But if you're doing something local, which is trying to keep everything together and tested and be able to have everything, you know, everything's being deployed the same way all the time, now maybe you've got some concerns about that. And the product itself. And I'm talking a little bit, yeah. I need to go back and make sure these don't bump up again. Docker the product. It's based around the concept of containers. If you're used to working with virtual machines, you know you have VHDs, and you've got all this other stuff, and generally things get very large. You've got your operating system in there, you've got all the stuff, and it really truly is self-contained and all inside. Docker containers are intended to be much lighter weight than that. They're meant to actually have some level of OS support in there, but not to duplicate everything across all the different containers. If you look at it, and I'll pull up Docker containers in a minute, but what we're looking at is, so you go to GitHub, or you use Git to do your source control, and you're basically doing all the diffs between all your different check-ins. You do a commit, and then you do another commit, and you can actually go back and see what all the changes were back and forth. Well, think about a Docker container is doing that exact same thing, but to whatever code you're deploying or whatever patches you put in there. As you're going forward, you're actually doing the same types of commits as things are going into the Docker container, so that you can actually make sure that everything is in place, but you're only doing diffs for every time you do that. Flip side of that is, Docker containers are completely stateless. Do not put data in a Docker container. This is a very bad thing. Because, A, you know that Docker container can go away at any point in time. This is I'm pointing to because the whole Azure, the compute units and things like that. No, data doesn't go in there. Data goes somewhere else, and unless you've got temporary or whatever, because you know it's not if it's going to be shut down, but when it's going to be shut down, when it's going to restart. And you can't pay attention to what's going on in that data if you're going to be reset all the time, and you need to worry about that consistency.
Cattle versus pets.
I'm sorry?
It's like cattle versus pets, is
yeah.
How I describe it.
That's a good one.
You have a pet you have to keep alive and protect, you know where it is and has a name and you love it.
And that's a cow and that's a cow and that's a cow.
Exactly.
Yep. Right. Yep. That's hamburger, steak, and ribs. But so that's what we're looking at with these containers. Think of them as very lightweight. Some of these are very tiny. For example, there's a couple of utilities that are deployed as Docker containers. 3 meg. We've got, for our entire system, probably 200 meg, 300 meg is what we're looking at for pushing those containers down, which means they're very small. You don't have the problem of, okay, I've got a VHD that's 20 gig. I've got to push down to keep track of it, all like that. In general, with VHDs, everything, and there's no diffs. You just get the whole thing unless you're actually doing checkpoints inside your system. And pushing those out someplace else is very dangerous to do with keeping them all in sync. So you're looking at things being very compact and very small, very easy to push up to other systems. But once you're doing that, you also want to be able to push and pull those. Just like with GitHub and Git and GitHub, you also want those repositories. So what you've got is there's a lot of different locations that are going together to give you some base images to start off with. You almost never, just like you almost never start a project these days with clean, you know, new project, blank solution. With Docker containers, you almost always start with something that's already pre-configured for you to give you that piece to get started. For example, the .NET Core, there's a specific, there's four different containers that you can start off with to do .NET Core. ASP.NET Core, just standard .NET Core, and then you've got each of those on a Linux Core and then on a Windows Core. So you've actually got those sitting in there, able to work back and forth and keep those things very tightly contained. People put those up, you can host your own. As a company, we actually have our own that we can literally have just a script that goes up with their devices when they're connected in. Every so often it comes up and says, hey, do I have an updated image? If it is, shut it down. Pull the diffs off on the image, which may be 1 or 2 meg, maybe larger, whatever that, but very simple, very quick to do, and then start it back up again and have it keep running. So working on that. Runtime environments, I just kind of talked about that a little bit, but just be aware of what you're doing with that. One of the key pieces, and I'll talk about this towards the end, is making sure that all those runtime environments and alternate runtimes are in sync. One of the challenges that we had with running Ubuntu was 16.04 is not fully compatible with the Docker runtime. The kernel is not fully compatible with the Docker runtime. So making sure all the pieces are supported can take a little bit of time to do. So keep an eye on that, know what you're doing with that, know what your target environment is going to be running. Again, if you're doing Azure, if you're doing AWS, they're going to tell you which version of Docker you really should be going on and which ones are tested against. But if you're doing other things, if you're doing local development inside of Docker, knowing that you might, knowing you're going to pay attention to it and see what you actually really need to have is pretty important, because otherwise you're going to be running around trying to figure out problems that, you know, that you don't really need to worry about, because it's actually going to be in the runtime and some compatibility.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. And the benefits. Why are we even looking at this? It's because basically what I've been saying is that repeatability. You know that every place it gets deployed, it's deployed the exact same way. If you're doing install scripts, if you're doing VHDs, VHDs are large, install scripts may or may not run completely correctly, may not be repeatable, you may have some problems with permissions, all of those kind of things. With the Docker container, it's all done right when you build the container, and everything gets pushed out the exact same way. Cloud deployment, being able to just go up and say, here, push it up there. By the way, I want 10 instances of this, or 2 instances of this, or always have me at least 3. This is the kind of same thing that we were looking at, again, with the compute units in Azure, what you're talking about with VHDs, with the virtual machines in AWS. And that's why both that size savings and that ability to just automatically spin up and spin down the images are why the cloud providers are really interested in having Docker. It's common, so to be able to put in that and to be able to work with that. Local deployment. Again, like I said, having it on my local machine meant that I can run it here, I can test it all out, I can actually do what I would do in the cloud, but do it when I'm disconnected or when I'm at 30,000 feet on an airplane. I don't have to be connected to the cloud service to do it all the time, but it's still running exactly the same way it would run up on there. And then the embedded options, and this is where I was talking about with me being able to do it embedded. I don't have to be logged in. I can actually just have those scripts, pull it down, work with it however I need to, on a device that may not have a monitor, may not have a remote desktop installed. It's just running there. I can actually come in, script it across the network, be able to see what's going on, control it completely with command line or SSH, and I'm good to go, because it makes it very, very easy to handle that back and forth and all around.
If it would be useful, I can give a couple of sentences about the Azure cloud deployment.
Sure.
This says here.
Absolutely.
So for Azure, you can do it in virtual machines just as you described, just spin up your flavor of Linux and it's Azure. But there's also a service called Azure Container Service that takes automated deployment of your Docker containers and will then orchestrate it with your choice of 3 orchestrators, Kubernetes, DCOS, or Docker Swarm. You choose the one you want, which will add the functionality you just described. So that's a managed service in Azure.
And now the limitations. One of the big problems that you're going to have with Docker, and this is one of the things that that doesn't show up to begin with, but then becomes a big pain as you go forward, is Docker's really built around creating new images, and creating new containers. If you want to go clean those up, or compress them, or actually put them all together, that's not something that's been really fleshed out with Docker as a base product. So if you're going through, if you're doing a lot of updates, if you're working with a lot of things, you're probably going to have to take probably about an hour every week or so and just go, okay, now let's, instead of having 15 commits on this one, let me actually pack it up so that I can actually have, I can actually know where we are, know what's going on. And it's not super easy to find out which one of it is, which one is which. I'll show you when I pull up the command line that you actually, everything's alphanumerics and all the kinds of fun stuff that are signatures. So keeping friendly names and keeping track of what you're doing sometimes gets to be a big challenge. So knowing that, and knowing that you're going to think of things a little bit differently because it's meant to really have all this stuff kind of machine understandable, and if you're not going to spend every day with it, you're probably going to have to make sure you keep notes about how to do that and how to actually go through and remove the old versions and compact them all down so you don't have 15 different check-ins and those kind of things. The runtime stability. Like I said, if you don't have everything lined up, the kernel, the containers themselves in the right versions, the tool sets in there, you can run into runtime stability problems. Now, the whole concept of Docker is, it's not going to, you know, you don't care if it crashes or not, it's just going to restart it or pop it in there. But you know, you do like your software stable. You do want it to be running all the time if you can help it. So keep an eye on that and just make sure that you're doing that tool chain and making sure it's all there. And the operating system choices. At the time when we started this, we just had Linux containers. Windows containers are now out now for supported. That was one of the big reasons for going to Hyper-V on Windows. But there are some other pieces you have to figure out, you know, what versions you're going to do in there, what capabilities you're going to have. Are you doing a BSD? Are you doing whatever's underneath the hood? And since you start with some containers, generally you'll start with a container and you're not installing from ground zero, sometimes keeping track of what's going on in those containers can be a little bit challenging, especially if you're doing Linux variants where you're doing apt-get updates and the rest of that, and things move around all the time. So keeping track of what's going on inside those and keeping track of which container has what in it is not always self-documented. So just be aware of that. And this will be, we'll just talk through this a little bit. This will be more in the examples when I actually get the course done. If you're installing Docker, first of all, Docker itself doesn't have a lot, doesn't have a UI. Everything's pretty much command line. And you're going to connect in with things. You're just going to type in the way you're going. It's very Unix, Linux driven that way. So be aware of that. There are some tools that you can go out and put it into play. There are some things that make it easier to work with. Most of those are kind of local web tools that you go ahead and put into place. The nice thing about having those tools is that, again, you can run it locally, you can manage remotely, and put all that into place and be able to work with that. Windows, you've got to have Hyper-V, and you've got to have Hyper-V activated. So make sure, I don't think anything really has a problem with Hyper-V these days, but if you've got machines that are a little bit older, that may be something you've got to pay attention to, especially if you're doing some of the, Atom systems. Since we do embedded, everybody keeps trying to give us an Atom chipset. That's not going to work for us for this kind of stuff because Hyper-V is not that happy with that. So going through all of that, the installation itself, going through and actually pulling it up, and again, I'm going to pull you up some information here on the command prompt. I'm not sure if you can read this or not, but basically what you're actually looking here is you can see what I've done up top is gone through and done that. Done a pull of a portainer, which is one of our tools that you can use to actually go through and help manage your tool sets there. You can see the different commits that has come through there. You get a digest, the signature on there, pull in the newest information, and you can see I was actually going through to do how to run it through that. Right up there, we got busy with some of the rest of it. And what we can see here is we've got one container that's up and running. It's the portainer. It's running, created about an hour ago. It's been up about an hour. You can see the ports that it's actually working for. And note that that's interesting because all these things are really built around web interfaces. So you're going to have ports that are going to be internal and external, that does cross. You can open it up to have a virtual network that's going on, or you can actually just tell it to use the host network stack. It's generally, if you're doing cloud, you're generally going to want that isolated network stack. If you're running it local, you actually get a lot more performance if you just let it use the native stack on the host operating system. So knowing how you put those together is going to be interesting. And then you can actually see the name there, which it gives you this weird, strange little names that it just generates randomly for you. So you can actually go through and try to figure out what the heck that is, because it, every time you start it up, it names it something different. Each of the instances, you can actually see what's going on in there. And what I'll also show you, and you can see what we've got here, is this is what I was talking about when things start really getting expanding out. So you can see WBC Drone is my company. And then we've got several different tools. We've got a coordinator and then the web UI. And you can see that all the different pieces pop up. They've got an image ID, which this is how you actually go through and manage each of the images you have on your machine. And it's all command line driven for what you're doing with this. So going in, connecting with them, working with them, that becomes a big challenge as you're moving back and forth across all of the Docker information.
So is that image ID similar to Git, where that's just the first few characters and it's really a string this long?
Yes, because if you saw the other one, you saw the big long SHA. This is generally good enough to get you what your access here. Okay. But yeah, there's a full signature on each of those as well. That's guaranteed not to be a collision. So. And then the back of the Linux, this will be again part of the course. Docker.com has a lot of the images to start working with. So bring it up and show you. This is our repository here. I've got basically those two containers that I'm really working with, which is our web UI and our coordinator. You see it's giving you both are our Linux variants, Ubuntu's. And this actually came out of the Git. Microsoft actually provides the starting images on these. These are the .NET, .NET Core and .NET Core ASP.NET. That actually started with these and then pushed out all the information on there. So you'll start off with that. You'll just do a Git pull, a pull like you would with GitHub, and drop it in there, and away you will go with that. You can actually see they put me on swarm mode, the swarming you were talking about. They're trying to get everybody going. It's nice and simple. You can always do a push back up. This is just basically the way to go in and drop that. And then you can actually see, I hope I'm still connected. We've got our tags, which you can put as many tags as you want to drop it in there. And you'll see that there's not a lot of build activity recently because I've gone through and done that. It's the automatic, you can actually do the automatic build with GitHub because the ASP.NET is not how Docker normally likes to build things. You can see the fail there, and I've never got all the way through that to be able to give you the rest of the details. But you can drop it in there. When you do a commit, it goes in and does that build for you. Everybody's got their own repositories. Start with Docker.com. You're still going to go out there, and you're going to do that pull, the Docker pull as you need to. But there's a lot of different things that are pre-configured for you. They tend to put a lot of tools inside it, and the tools are actually pushed out for Docker, are pushed out as Docker containers. So you're actually going to be using Docker to run the add-ons for Docker, which is kind of interesting. Doing that, you need to be logged in. So again, this is one of those pieces where you saw me going in and doing the web page. But to actually work with the images, do the command line login, because all that other stuff is kind of hidden behind it, and you see right there, and I have to remember, let me see if I remember correctly. Yep. Anyway, you get logged in with that. Let me try one more time. I'm flipping this. And now I'm just embarrassed that I can't remember.
That's okay. You have like 25-30 passwords to remember.
Well, I've been very frustrated with LastPass. That's my password manager, and I think if you saw.
Yesterday,
the latest news on that. I've got to figure out what I can do with that. Anyway, you go through there, and then once you get that done, you can do pulls and pushes and actually do to either your repository. Of course, Docker wants you to go to their repository, the registry there, but you can actually use that for any particular repository you want. There's the ability for you to actually host your own. We just use them because it's nice and simple, and I didn't want to spend the time setting up the infrastructure for something we were testing out trying to put in. You actually go in and do that pull on an image. You saw what was going on. It's literally just like you would with GitHub. You just tell it, do a pull on a particular image. It pulls it down, and you see all your images that you've got available. running image. Each of the images comes down, they're sitting there, and then you have to actually kick them off. You can actually kick them off so that they run once, and then they can be stopped if the system goes down and comes back up. Or you can actually go through and tell it to make sure that you're always running, or however many you want to have running. So you can actually go through and have a bunch of different commands on it to tell it what's going on. When you're running it, you also get the capability of telling it how to, where it passes its data. You have map drives, which go on to persistent storage that you've been working on. You can actually have redirect ports on the web stack around, so that you can actually use, say if it's a, say if you got a port 80, typical port on one image, you can actually tell the images to move off to different ports, or you can have them share on that and do some load balancing on that. So you get to choose how you want to put those into place. You don't have to actually go in and change anything on the image to actually change where, how you're talking with that on different things. So you can handle collisions pretty easily on that side. And then you connect to the image, actually going in. You can either, if it's talking on web on a web port, go in, connect just like you would any website, or you can actually connect in through command line, connect to the running image, and go through there and do things like apt-get or updates or all those kind of things that you would normally do if you're sitting on it with an SSH, because basically that's what you're doing. If you connect into a Windows image, you get a cprompt. If you're connecting in with a Linux image, then you're just getting a terminal and running from there. So again, once you do that, you're actually inside the image, and it becomes kind of interesting working with that. This is how you, sometimes you can build up those and work with it. And then just go through and stop in the image. You actually go through and say which one of those images you actually have. If you want to stop, you can do one or groups of them, bring them up, push them back down again, and work with it that way. And there's your here's what you're most interested in. Customizing the container. You start with your base image. You go through and you pull it. Like I said, you do the .NET Core. Go through and pull that into place. Install any packages you need. This is one of those pieces where, depending upon what you've got, you can add those or remove. You can add or remove all kind of things you want. For example, in my coordinator service, because this was running Linux, I wanted to make sure that I had a speech synthesizer. There are several different packages. One of the things you do is go in there and do an apt-get install, and whichever package you want, just connect it in there. However, you can actually go through a Docker file, which I'm going to show you in just a second, which lets it automatically generate that each and every time. This is where your tools in Visual Studio are going to help, because you can actually go through there and say, okay, here's all the things I want in there, and rebuild this for me every time to make sure it's always going to be consistent in there. Install the custom code. Again, you can actually pull it off of a shared drive. You can have Visual Studio drop it in. It'll pull in that shared drive, copy it over, and then remove the drive again for you. Do your checkpointing. So once you get it all kind of in place, what you want to do is say, do a checkpoint. Make sure that this is it. And then you can roll back to the checkpoints, commit, and then push it up to your repository as you saw there. So you can actually go through again. This is very, should be very similar to what you see with you doing a Git project. It's just you're doing a build with an operating system. And as I do that, what I will show you here is the Docker file. Just a second. I do love that ability to just roll the text up. For forever, that was a pain to find. So you can see here, it's telling this Docker file is very simply how it all puts everything into place. Microsoft ASP.NET Core 1.1.0, so it actually knows what it's working with. It's got to be registered locally. You pull it down, but now it's knowing which one of the pieces are coming into place. Source is from this. Work directory is app, so it will take your directories and drop it in there. And you can see this is actually generated for you by the tool sets. My wife always knows when I'm in front of people. She's an incredible student. So you can see right there, it's going, here, let's find. Let's find where we need to pull out that information and move it over into the app. So this handles it for you automatically. When you do a build, the Docker file will tell it where all that goes into place. The URLs, we're using port 5000, and exposes on 5000. So we're actually saying internally it's 5000, externally it's 5000, so we're in good shape on that, matching it all up. And then where it actually starts from, when it starts when you start up the container, What's it going to do? It's just .NET, and this is our web UI. If you notice, very interesting with this, it's actually going through there and knowing how to do the publishing as well. So that debug netcore app 1.1 publish. If you've done any .NET cores, you know that you have to actually do, you have to actually go through and do a publish for it to actually generate where it comes out with, rather than kind of the command, rather the tools you do with a traditional website. So he actually goes through and puts all that in place. It all happens every time, and it's all in good shape for you. You've actually got the additional ability to go in and do different pieces with the image. This is going to say, this basically says the WBC drone web UI. So it now knows what this image is going to be, and then put a tag on there because you can actually tag it with different pieces, so you know what's going on, different builds, things like that. The Docker file tells it where to use the Docker file if you want to change it out, the ports, and all the rest of that. So you can go through and do all of this and compose changes if you're in debug, if you're on final. So you can go through all of that, and then the Docker ignore. It's just nice, simple. Don't put the compose and don't put the Docker file in there. You don't want to just ignore that. Again, just like a Git ignore or a Visual Studio ignore that you can work with on that. So, nice and simple. And you've got all the other images and the rest of that in there. So you've got, and basically pretty simple to go through and put it all into place, but you've got a lot of control over it, especially when you get very complex with these. Let me see if I have the, as you can see, a more complex one. This is the one that I've got with the service in there. So you can see that we have actually got a lot more information going. I've got some script. I've got a script there, the Wi-Fi scan script that has to go into a different location when it's generating that. It's got the. I can go through and do the change mods, change it around the app to get. Assume yes. Assume yes means don't wait for me to hit yes on that because nobody's sitting here watching that. So you can go through and do the install of various pieces on there. Expose the port 8844, which I do communications over the UDP. So we have control over it, not just with the. With the TCP bit, but also with UDP, so that can all go in place. And see, now you've got the bash, bin bash, C, .NET coordinator, .NET coordinator. So you can go through and make this as complex as you want to, as sophisticated as you want to. You can actually go through there. This is literally just a script file that's being run when it creates that when it creates that container. So you've got everything you need in there, and you can actually go forward and do what you what else you want in there. You've got full control over it. Most of the time, you're not going to want to do too much on this. But if you need it, like I did here, you can actually go through and do all kinds of fun stuff. And there we go. And that Docker file is key. So if you're going through there doing that, that's what you want to go. That's what you want to go through and have that handle a full description of what's going on. Be able to test, be able to validate that what you've got in there is what you need. And then you can the Visual Studio, the tools will actually work with it to help automatically update it. If you move things around, if you actually change locations, if you do some different pieces with the projects, it's going to go there. But manual updating is when you have to do things like the you saw the scripts and the package update, package installs and things like that. I have to manually go in and put that in place. I've got full control both ways. It can handle it for me, make it easy, or I can go through and make it as complex and as sophisticated as I want to. And the deploying. Into Visual Studio. Visual Studio Docker support is handled there, just a small little piece. I was just telling everybody I've still got a load of Visual Studio 17 because I've been busy writing and I don't want to do two development platforms right now. But the 17 has some advances in the tool sets to make it a little bit easier to do. One thing to note though is keep up to date because as Docker updates, Visual Studio tools need to be updated as well. Docker is bad about making breaking changes. They're being very agile. They're being very very fast. They're adding tools in very quickly, which means that if you've got Docker set to do auto updates and you go back in and go okay and it's storing errors, your tool set probably needs to be updated to get back in sync with what's going on with Docker. Pretty easy to do, but it's also easy to forget when you're going. I just made all these changes and what did I break? You didn't break anything. It's the tools behind the scenes that updated. Right. And then, yes?
I'm just saying that's a cool feeling. trust my environment.
Well, this is also where NuGet gets me as well. This whole, how many dependencies did, I'll just add this. How many dependencies did I just get?
Yeah.
And when are you going to update them? And I'm going to have to figure out what's going on. So yeah, it kind of goes with the territory. Welcome to the web.
Yeah.
The modern web where everything has changed. And did anybody, what was it, about 6 months ago, the wonderful story with the guy who broke the internet.
Yeah.
Just, I'm taking my stuff down and half the internet breaks. And they go, what changed? Nothing in your code. It's just it was doing a call out somewhere else. Those are the kind of things that we're looking at with some of these tools. Just be aware of it because you know you're going to run into some of the problems with it is there.
Say, Phil?
Yes.
So if you have issues with installing Visual Studio 2017, I know it's kind of a pain. One option might be if you have an MSDN subscription, there are images in Azure with it pre-installed that you can just launch it from. So some of my customers like that.
I know I'm going to install it, so the throwaway environments I just haven't worked on, and it's been just getting the job done.
Well, like I say, you don't have to install it.
Yeah.
You pick the image in Azure and it comes up.
Yep.
Might save you some time. Microsoft updates it too, so you can pick all the latest versions of it.
Yep. So as you're deploying those, the auto Docker builds. This is the piece that I was talking about, is if you're using GitHub we are, you can actually do a link in GitHub over to Docker. And you can say, now we've got a connection with integration points. Every time I do that check-in and push up into GitHub, it will automatically do that build for me with Docker and push it over into and give me an image that's just ready to go. It's one of those pieces where it's nice and simple, and it's one of those pieces that if you're going to use their repository anyway, it means you don't have to push everything up. It's going to build it on their services, and they're going to handle it. It makes it easier for you to actually keep everything organized. Personally, I like keeping it down because I want to do that test before I push it up and let my customers possibly pick it up. So, but it depends upon how you're doing things. I'm also, because I'm doing a lot of hardware work, it's kind of hard to do build test cases to figure out how your 50 mega samples a second are going to be pushed into that and handled inside the hardware. One of those pieces. The Docker in the cloud, just being able to go up there and not just push it up there, but actually have an auto update on the Docker repository or on several others. Not just build your Docker container, but then automatically start it or automatically update it to the latest version of whatever is going on there. Azure, I believe, has that capability as well.
Yeah, it's got a private repository. Visual Studio Team Services now has Linux build agents as well, if you want. So
all of that's capable.
Yep.
It's just pipelining this so that you just write what you need to, and all the infrastructure's handled for you. This is the whole fun part. The part that makes DevOps actually bearable is that you can automate all this stuff, and that you should never need to worry about it. You just go through, write your code, check your tests, do your commit, and then everything else is running in production, because that's the wave of the future. Let's test our data. Let's test our systems in production.
Deploy to production. I'm just the time today.
Yeah,
that's right.
And the Docker to GitHub and the local Docker. Just being able to have it locally, be able to run it there. Actually, be able to see what's going on, how it's going to behave when you push it up. But actually, do that local environment. So you're not testing with that. You're not doing your tests with your customers running live on whatever you just pushed up. You can actually do that check and make sure that everything's running fine before you do the push up into the cloud. And then going through and doing your environments, your hosts, you saw what was going on when I was coming up there with we've got the host, it's got all the images, all the different versions, and going through there and figuring out which one's which is sometimes a bit of a pain.
What do you mean by compressing the versions?
Compressed, yeah. What happens is, and let me drop it right back over. And pull it up. You can actually see up here. You can tell what I've got going on is I've got several versions of the different pieces here. Version. So a lot of these are different version, different versions like I'm doing with those commits. What you want to do is every so often, you want to just compact that up, because when it does a pull on a, when it's a pull on one of the images, it pulls all those commits sequentially, just like again what you would see with Git. I pull down the base and then I pull down the up and up and up. And it's a lot simpler just to go through and go, okay, this is what I want. I've tested it. I know where it needs to be. So compress all of these images down and just flatten it out. So it's the same thing as if you're doing hyper-V image and you've got checkpoints all the way through, you go, just go, just bring me up to speed. This is where I need to go. Drop out all those checkpoints and get me my VHD back into a known state. That's what you're doing with the version compressing there.
Sorry, I'm not following you. Just is this like you pick
pick one of your commits.
Follow and you wipe out the other ones.
Well,
you don't propagate.
They're all folded into one version rather than having pull down four or five check-ins, mm-hmm. or maybe 10 or 12 check-ins. Okay. It basically takes it and compresses that all down into just one image. So you're just pulling down that one. Now that means you can't roll back to any of those previous commits, right, or those previous versions, but it becomes easier to manage that you don't have to figure out what's going on with that on the different versions. You're just back into a single file of truth. Is what you're looking for. Okay. Does that make sense?
I think so.
It's like a Git squash.
It squashes exactly. It's the exact same concept. Because you can see, as you're going through and doing these different builds, and it's actually doing updates and derivatives as it goes through there, it can get very confusing to go through and go, what is this? Especially since the names are very similar, or they're going to be the same, and just the image ID you're changing. And at that point, it can be very difficult to manage where are we and what's going on. Just be able to go, and the squash just goes, drop it in there, this is the one I've got, now let me push it up, and then just go in this one piece. And there is a bit of overhead when you're pushing those different versions in, because it's going to go, get me the next one, they're each different calls. So if you've got it just in one piece, you don't have any worries about the connection not being up the whole time, or if something happened as it's pulling it down, you've just got the full container as it sits there. And then going through there and, like I say, cleaning up your containers, then you can see that they get a lot of old ones get in there. You actually have a lot of things that you're trying and moving around, making sure that you've got those image names and going through. It's a manual process. You've got to go through and basically tell it Docker delete and this particular, that image number. You can even give it the name, because each of the names is an instance of one of those image numbers. So cleaning up those can become a little bit time consuming and difficult to do. That you've got in place, and then managing your private container repositories. Those are those pieces, like I showed you with that we've got a private repository up. Go in, make sure that you've got all of that, especially if you're doing the auto builds and if you're doing those kind of things. You've got to do the same thing that you did with your local containers. You've got to work with those repositories, make sure they're in good shape. You've got your maintenance there, things cleaned up there. So, just a little bit of work. And then the considerations. This is the kind of good, bad, and indifferent. Make sure that you've got that supported host. That's probably the biggest thing I can tell you, is making sure, especially with the different changes and with the different versions of everything and all the different moving parts with Docker, keeping that chain in a supported state can actually be a little bit challenging, because they do push out updates very regularly. Docker does do breaking changes. And keeping track of everything that's going correctly and making sure all of your pieces are updated can take a little bit of time to do. I do recommend that you probably turn off the auto Docker update just so that you're in a known state and just do that. Know when you're going to pull those updates. You go, okay, I'm going to spend a little bit, I'm going to hit it, and then I know that that happened or not. And if there's a problem, then I can go work with that. The isolation. The benefits there is that you've got that isolation, but you don't have to worry about, again, if it's cloud or if it's whatever, all the different runtimes, because it's a Docker container that moves across all of these different services in all of these different ways. As long as you're in a supported host, that's going to operate the same across whatever you want to do. So you've actually got that isolation that's managing to go, I'm running on my desktop, I'm running running on the server, I'm running on a Mac, I'm running on a BSD or Ubuntu or whatever. You're actually not have to worry about that. Again, just like a virtual, just like you would a virtual machine. But now that you've got, but now you've got the situation where it's a lot smaller, it's a lot lighter weight. You're not having to use all those resources to have big VHDs all over the place. They're nice and tiny and easy to move around and work with that. In addition, you can also do things like have heterogeneous hardware systems. So again, we can actually have, for what I'm doing, I can have my laptop plus an Intel NUC plus a Mac, and all of those interoperating inside the Docker containers, because I do that. Everything's together. You know it's there. You just have to worry a little bit about some of those situations where, again, where the hosts don't behave exactly the same. Things like being able to give it, it's called privilege mode, is what I have to do to get to access with USBs. And on Linux, I basically start it up and say, you've got high privileges, and it goes, okay, I can give it, you can get this USB device, or you can get access to all the USB devices, however you want to set it up. And that kind of breaks that layer down into the real hardware, so you can actually have that working together. So just be aware of that. Performance is generally very good. VHDs are sometimes very performant, sometimes not. Things have been getting better and better, but there's still that overhead of you're an operating system on an operating system, because Docker has those lightweight containers that are using the host for a lot of those systems. You're not going through that additional level of abstraction that you sometimes have to do with a virtual machine. So you actually get a little bit better performance off that. Things like the network stack, you get to choose whether you use the host network stack or you're actually doing a virtualized network stack. The virtualized network stack allows you to do the remapping and all those kind of fun things there. Reliability. Don't count on reliability. Again, this is the whole point of trying to move into this and with swarms is it'll make sure that you have an instance running. Not guaranteed to be the same instance. You've got all this kind of stuff, and again, because as they're moving it around, keeping it as simple as possible in there is really good. That being said, you actually gain back a lot of that reliability when you're using Docker containers, because everything that you used to have as a service becomes a container. So you see how I've got our system broken up, where we've got the coordinator, which handles all the data reading. We've got the UI that handles all of that. Literally, I can break it up into smaller pieces that talk back and forth. It's all going back and forth over UDP is how those communicate back and forth, and then goes out on a web interface. So breaking them up into small, discrete, individual components means that you're going to have more reliability because everything's simpler, you're having less interactions. So pay attention to that. So it's a little bit of a trade-off of knowing how it fits and what's going on. This is also a situation where you're not going to be running things like desktop managers, or you're not going to be running GUIs in there. So it becomes a lot more reliable, it becomes a lot lighter weight for your performance back and forth. Again, I've talked a little bit about the updates. The nice thing about Docker, though, is that you can do your updates as those commits and just push across things, whatever the changes are. So you're actually able to go, for my example, the first one, the web UI is, I think, 230 meg. A lot of it's graphics. But once that base image is there, we're only changing a couple of files every time we added features and things like that. So generally, the updates are tiny. So getting those out into devices that have very low bandwidth is really, really valuable. It's able to go out there, do it really quickly, push that to where it needs to be, and the downtime is almost instantaneous because it takes so quick to drop it out and pull it back up. So that's a big benefit there of pushing those updates. And you also know that your updates are consistent. If you're going through and trying to make sure that everything's updated correctly, that you didn't forget anything, all of those kind of pieces, you know, that's the Windows installer doing deployments, we don't do that anymore. You know, that's not, you know, you can do some internal stuff with modern apps, but that doesn't work for everything that you're doing in a modern web app kind of thing. Yeah. But being able to go through there and making sure that it's all packaged, it's all going exactly where it wants to, and you can test it, and then it becomes repeatable to deploy out to as many systems as you want to, that becomes very valuable. And then making sure that you can do your production wherever you want to. Again, like I said, we've got ours set up so we can actually spread it out amongst multiple machines that may be heterogeneous, that they're actually different operating systems on the rest. It's running like that. Or we could actually take it, put it in the cloud, and put it on one embedded computer, stick it in a cabinet, and away it goes. So you've got all those options for how you can actually go into production, and you're isolated from having to worry about what that means behind the scenes. So those are your benefits for using Docker. Just be aware that it is as popular as it is, it's also moving very quickly, and things are happening very, very fast. So be prepared for being ready to go out and go, let me make sure that it's all up to date. I know exactly what's going on here. It's the day of the cloud. Everything's changing constantly behind the scenes, deploying hundreds of times a day. Mm-hmm. They believe that as well. So if you've got those auto updates, just know what's. Be prepared to spend a little bit of time keeping up with what they're doing, because you're going to need to. That's kind of the rundown. Yes.
Is Docker the only game in town as far as the containerization concept?
There are other things. There are other offerings like this. But it's very web-focused. It's one of those where they're the popular one. So you see everybody kind of focusing in on Docker as a container. Microsoft's done, DevDiv has gotten very excited about it, and the Azure team has. Mm-hmm. Wow. Google's got their own pieces. Azure's been doing it. AWS has been working on it pretty heavily for a while.
Yeah.
It makes the infrastructure simpler. And like I said, there are others. I don't know many people using any of the others unless they're just wanting to be different, because that's one of the big benefits, is it's a consistent container story no matter where you go across. So you can actually make things, it keeps down your complexity by just focusing on Docker. Any other questions? Yes?
I'd like to see that picture of your drone that you were doing.
What?
The one that you actually did the code, the drone detector.
Okay.
Just the image, please.
Oh, just the device?
Just the device.
Oh, okay. So that's... I see it every day, so I'm like, okay.
Is it doing image processing?
No image processing. One of our competitors is doing video recognition. The problem with that is that you go sub-pixel very, very quickly, even with a 4K camera. And there's also the problem of a lot of drones look like soaring birds, especially the fixed wing ones.
Yeah.
And if I can't look at it and tell what it is, I'm not going to tell a computer to figure that one out either. I know deep learning and all that stuff. Work on that.
So how are you detecting?
I'm doing RF. A couple of different approaches with RF. It's all passive. So basically what I'm doing is, and there's the system. It's all passive, which means that we don't have the problems that radar has, or a lot of the active stuff where you interfere with things and you're doing all that kind of stuff. But yeah, there it is. This runs on a little Intel NUC inside, nice embedded computer, all in one. All kinds of, couple little fun pieces in there of custom hardware design. Most of it's kind of off the shelf, and these are around the world right now, so kind of fun and interesting to see. This one's actually the V3. The V4 has another antenna sticking out the top of it as well to give us some additional range. So,
first and foremost, everybody,
thank you for putting up with one of my less polished presentations. I apologize about that, guys.
You might be putting up the skateboard of imagination.
So, this is for those, especially those online. Now, Phil's come down from Austin to present for us. I'm very thankful. It's a pretty big favor that he's done for us. So, the idea here is, Phil's showing you Docker after about a few nights of no sleep and a drive down from Austin. And the important thing is, what I want to highlight, set things in perspective. So he's given us a presentation of a course material that he's written for a company. He's now showing us something that he does as his full-time gig, where he's writing drone detection. Everybody can build a drone now. You can actually buy a kit, I guess, now. So, every Tom, Dick, and Harry can fly some mechanical stuff.
how do you prevent yourself, how to keep yourself safe, is already in this arena. This is V3, as you mentioned, there's a version 4 that they already have in production. So the point is, if you are here, you would get to ask questions that don't necessarily relate to the presentation. You get to meet Adam Hems, Chief Solution Architect, I guess, if I got the CSA right.
Cloud
Solutions. This is about the same thing. There's a C somewhere there. But you'll be able to get some direct info from what's current at Microsoft. You would meet Scott, who lives and breathes Java. You would meet Alan. This is a very fluid user-to-user helping one another kind of meet. Now, of course, if everybody is on the heavier side and looking at big data, you would have John Hellman, whom you missed last time. But the point is, you come here, you get to meet senior guys, you get to meet guys who actually do stuff. You can ask questions that spin off from the actual focus of that day's meeting. So we're not limited. I've asked Phil to actually show you this. Now, this is important for you to see, because it sets a certain perspective of when Phil says something about Docker, and he says, well, you know, when you do it here and you do it there. Well, for those of you who don't know Phil, you can actually look up the videos, and hopefully he'll be able to show you this. All the code written for this example that he's going to pull up was written by Phil. So on one end, you can see him writing drone detection. On the other end, you're going to see how he has written code, all the code that's written here.
So this is imagination, not awesomeness.
I'll let the video speak for itself. So those of you who didn't come, you're lost.
So the common thing you'll see about projects I do is very much focused on sensors. This was one, actually, do we have audio?
It's high on me, I don't think the speakers.
Let's just cut.
Yes, we did. This was the second project we did with the labs group.
But that's not going to work for me. We'll be confused.
Yeah.
Because it will emit what state of mind I've got. Right?
Well, we'll let it run, and I'll tell you one of the nice pieces, one of the nice stories on that one, Phil.
And we're here to show you the following to the board of awesomeness, the board of imagination, which instead of being powered by Connect, is powered by this and the other handset. So you're going to tell them how it works.
Well, let's just start with the board to the top, in case you missed our wonderful board of awesomeness. We actually have a great behind this, the Samsung tablet running Windows 8 developer preview.
We actually have our USB cable that runs up underneath, where we connect in with our wireless transmitter for our headset. It detects your brain waves. It actually figures out where you want to go. You imagine yourself being there, and it actually takes you forward.
Piloting the board is pretty simple. It's actually a lot easier than our first version. What you do is you take the remote headset, and once you make sure that it contacts the noise, you simply put it on your head, adjust it right above your ears, make sure all of the contacts are in the right position, and then it starts picking up the signals from your brain. So that's how you make it go. So basically what I'm doing is imagining a point in the future, getting closer, and then stopping.
This is one of the pieces we're talking. When you hear people talk about IoT, when you hear people talk about all this new stuff that's happening, this is what you should be thinking about: is how sensors work. What we're doing there is actually working with three factors: perceptive, predictive, and pervasive computing. What happens when the keyboard goes away, when the mouse goes away, and you're actually working with all of your systems very differently than you see what I'm doing with the drone detection system, being able to actually work with the sensors, being able to go, what's around here? How do I filter out what I don't need to do to find clues around of my environment that are things that I'm interested in and being able to alert people and let them know what's going on very quickly and very accurately and very appropriately. What do we need to do? This was basically a bit of a stunt. If you look on the upper right-hand corner, that's actually, you would know the Gadget Show.
Actually, I don't know the Gadget Show.
In the UK, Jason Bradbury. That's actually Jason Bradbury up there.
Okay. Not lived there for 17 years.
Oh, no. He's Mexican.
Yeah, I'm American now.
But
it's all good.
Jason is basically, if you think of it as Top Gear for tech. He's got a bunch of guys like that. But this is the story I was going to tell you. Let me see if I can get it. This was an interesting.
Why had Cliff been blown away by the top?
This was a. Let's see if I can just stop it for a second.
A mind control.
Mind control skateboard. Here's the backstory for this one, and I will tell this one for just a bit. We actually went out here with the board of Awesomeness, which was the Kinect version. They didn't tell us where we actually met them out in LA. They didn't tell us where they were going to film. This is Venice Beach. It's a little sunny in Venice Beach at noon. Mm-hmm. And we had some challenges with the Kinect. Kinect is built to become inside and stable, and there's all this stuff. We were pushing to see how far we could go with Kinect. We come out there and go, yeah, this isn't going to work. Should we try the new one? So we pulled. This was the first time we'd actually gone out and had somebody else try the Board of Imagination. And we're going, Roland was going to do it, and then the Jason Bradbury is very enthusiastic about it. He's the host of the show. He's like, no, I've got to write it. And we're going, we can't let him write it. We're going to kill him. We're going to kill him on TV. And so we're going, okay, he's very enthusiastic. He's very excited. If you've ever seen the show, you would realize just how excited he is. But you have to put all this saline on your head to make sure you get good contacts and everything like that. I met the guy. He comes out, and we look at his head and go, yes! This we can work with. Of course, the flip side of that is, you're about distracted. This is Venice Beach. I'm walking along, Worley's my rider. I'm going, you're going to die. Two girls come by. But some fun stories. These are all up on. This is all up on YouTube. So just search for Board of Imagination, Board of Awesomeness, and the other one we did, which was the Smarter Cart, which was a shopping cart that follows you around Whole Foods and keeps track of all of everything for you. They were actually Microsoft showed off at the House of the Future. Mm. So yeah, R&D wrote a check for $6.5 billion that year. Showed off our stuff. Pretty cool.
But you didn't get that.
Hmm?
The $6.5 million.
Yeah.
No,
did you
no,
get
no.
that check?
No.
But he's the kind of guy, even if he got it, he'd come.
Yes.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
So we're lucky to have that, at least.
Yes.
So, yeah, we're very blessed to have that. So, thank you, Phil. Thank you for this. And the reason I'm trying to show you all this is, he's actually doing an IoT focus session in June. And I'm going to personally make sure that he sleeps at least the night before.
I will bring the toys to that. That is a little bit kind of...
Toilets.
Yeah, it's software, it's a virtual machine, blah, blah, blah. I will bring the toys for the next one, and you can get to see some fun stuff.
That's June. So, the important
thing... I think I've got sleep schedules somewhere before.
Yes. Because I'm actually very thankful that he made it, because he was really under the... You are better with work and lack of sleep. So...
It's typical startup.
Yeah, I know. And as you can see, he has a lot of labels. And I'm going to share something else with y'all. He's been one of our key advisors from the time Hybrid Decisions has been around. So...
I'll push you beyond that, because I think I'm the one who told you to get out and make hybrid decisions happen.
That was the second comment. Separate it. Safe, keep things safe. Yeah. So, but in all honesty, that's pretty much, we were in the same time frame. So, hybrid decisions, by the way, that's the company we work for. That's the company that sponsors the Cloud Group, that started the Cloud Group in 2008. Single sponsor, carries it through.
and primarily done as a way of giving back to this community that actually gave us. So purely community effort. That's our focus. And the intention behind all this is the next generation, that's the ones after us, take over slowly, and then let us sit down and start, you know, watching the world go by. So that's one. Two, the next month, the session is going to be from a guy who Microsoft, I think people who cut some mustards make it to this level called MVPs in Microsoft, and you're an MVP in a technology, and then you end up with a guy who's the MVP of MVPs. They have an award and all that stuff. The guy who's actually coming to present next month is the C++ MVP. I know, as soon as you hear that word, you go, oh my God, that guy is deep tech. Yes, deep tech, so tightly involved with the people who actually brought C++ into Azure many years ago. And we had the guy who built some of that stuff present for the C++ cloud group combination. That was many years ago from Redmond. Now, the guy, when David comes next month and he's presenting, the topic may be whatever it is. But you're welcome to hit him up with questions that don't necessarily stop with C++. It could be Java, it could be JavaScript. He's all over the place. A pure technologist, just like Phil. I'm pretty much hanging on to that same label too, but basically, next month, David Gravy, C++ guy, on something with the cloud. We'll be putting up the brief in the next week or so. And Phil,
yes.
June,
yes.
IoT with the toys. We're going to just call it the toy show. And thank you, Phil. Thank you for coming. Thank all of you and those of you online. Thank you for coming. Sign in again and enjoy. I hope you start sending questions to Valentino and or HCCUG, and so we can start answering these for you or get the answers for you from whomever. All right? Everybody good? Any other questions? Thank you, sir. Thank you.